beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is. The name.
Good morning, Calvary. If you're still in the atrium, would you please make your way out to or into the auditorium? We welcome you to come in. Before we begin today, I want to clarify something. We had last week a little glitch with microphones when I began my sermon, and if you were watching online, you know that the first couple of minutes of what I was saying was not heard. And then, therefore, a lot of what I said was not in context after that. And I have had multiple phone calls and conversations with people today about this being my last Sunday at Calvary because I'm retired. That's not true. If you have questions about what this transition is going to look like over the next 18 months, then please talk to me, okay? But don't spread any false information. All right. Welcome to Calvary, and we would love to meet you if you're new here today, or if you've been coming a couple of weeks but you haven't gotten us your contact information. Out at our Connect desk in the atrium, there's a QR code on a couple of pages of paper that are standing up in stanchions, and if you just scan those with your phone, it'll take you to a registration form. Fill that out so that we can be in touch with you. Would you all stand for our call to worship this morning? Taken from Revelation and from 1 Timothy. Great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we have several announcements today we want to run through. Important one. First impressions are very important. And when new people come to our church, the first impression they get is usually of the person who's opening the door for them, or the person who's standing at the Connect desk to give them new information about our church. And we need people like you who can make a good first impression. Right after church today, in the Nexus Youth Room, we're going to have a meeting to facilitate the building of our first impressions team. And we would invite you to come if you're interested in that ministry. Whether you're new or you've already been a part of that ministry, we invite you to attend that meeting right after church. There's still time to volunteer to serve in our exciting Awana program that starts this Wednesday night. Please use the registration tab on the Church Center app on your phone. You can also use the Church Center app to register your students. And if you don't have that available to you, contact the church office. There are several women's Bible studies that are also starting this week. All the details are on the Church Center app, and you can register there, or you can stop by the table in the atrium after church today and meet the facilitators of those classes, and you can find out more information about them personally. Next Sunday, big change in the schedule at Calvary. Faith Builders and Bible Link will start next week at 9:15 a.m. We will have multiple adult classes. They're all listed on the Church Center app under Studies, or you can pick up an information sheet in the Atrium Information Center. Children's classes from nursery all the way up through middle school. High schoolers will be serving and also going to adult classes. Something for everybody at 9:15 starting next Sunday. And then we need nursery help because of the additional needs in our nursery for such things. And we would invite you to sign up to help in the nursery during Faith Builders Hour and the church service. You can sign up again on the Church Center app or talk to Rochelle Salibi. And where's Rochelle? There she is, way back in that corner over there. So find her. Put your hand up again, Rochelle. There she is. Okay, talk to her if you can help in the nursery, please. Dave Johnson, come on up here a minute, and he's got a couple of special invites for you.
A couple? One?
You have life group and course calls.
Oh.
Right?
Yeah, I guess. So next Sunday, I'm going to be teaching the CORES class, which is for anyone who wants to really understand more of the inner workings and beliefs of Calvary, our history, and especially as you're considering becoming a ministry partner. So I invite you to come at 9:15 next week for that group if it meets your needs and interests. The other thing is I'm helping to coordinate for life groups. And the word says that God gives us the unity of the Spirit, but we're to preserve the unity of the Spirit. And how can we preserve that unless we get to know each other beyond first impressions? We need to go deeper. And so life groups are just a way for you to go meet new friends, go deeper with other friends, and that we can love each other unconditionally and be there for each other. So I'm going to be in the corner as you leave with more information on life groups if you're ready to try that ministry out.
Thank you, Dave. Next Sunday, then, also, in addition to the Faith Builders Hour and Children's Ministries at 9:15, worship service starting next Sunday will begin at 10:30, not 10 o'clock. So if you're early, you will be automatically assigned to a Faith Builders discipleship class so that you're not bored. There are men's and women's retreats that are coming up at Arrowhead Bible Camp. There's brochures in the information center, and there's also more information available in the church office or by contacting Apple or going to their website for the Apple Walk that comes up this Saturday, September 18th. We have a wonderful privilege to worship the Lord in a variety of ways in our lives. Our entire lives are supposed to be a worship unto the Lord, and one of the ways we do that is in the management of our resources. In Psalm 54, we read this, "Behold, God is my helper. The Lord is the upholder of my life. With a free will offering, I will sacrifice to you. I will give thanks to your name, O Lord, for it is good." Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the provisions for each of us for every day to sustain life with the meeting of our basic needs. Thank you for generously sowing more than we need into our lives. And may we be found faithful with all that you give us to return to you an offering that reflects how much we love you for what you have given us. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we'd like to dismiss all the children ages 3 through 3rd grade to Discover Link. Parents, escort your children back there, please. The rest of us, please stand as we continue to worship our most glorious Savior, Jesus Christ.
Isaiah 28:16 says, "Behold, I am the one who is laid as a foundation in Zion, a stone, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. Whoever believes will not be in haste." And Psalm 118:22 says, "The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." And 1 Corinthians 3:11 says, "For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ."
The church is one foundation. It is Jesus Christ the Lord. She is His new creation by water and the Word. From heaven He came and sought her to be His holy bride.
Schedule, there are two opportunities to pray corporately. Weekdays from 8 to 8:30 we meet on Zoom, and if you need some of those details, I'm sure the church office or myself could send those to you. And also Tuesday evenings from 7 to 8 in the Nexus room, and I would encourage you to ponder and consider either of those opportunities. We have a few requests today that Stacy Sias' brother-in-law was flown in from Medford this week and is on a ventilator, and it's just a difficult situation. They don't know how much improvement they can expect or what it's going to be, so just continue to lift him in your prayers and just the Sias' family. Also, Eric Killinger's brother has some brain lesions and some tears, and they're trying to do some more assessment today, so you can pray for him and also Eric. And then also, sometimes there's just some requests that at times I struggle with how to continue to pray, and so that's with the Grant family. Dan's still in the hospital, Fred and Sandy are there and with the family, and so I'm just at a loss for words, and so it's okay to be at a loss for words of what to say and just to lift them up to the Lord. So let's just have a few minutes and pray over these requests, and that'll close us in a word of prayer. Merciful Father, we thank you for who you are, that you care for us in such a way that you know our requests before they're on our lips, and you intercede for us in ways that we, with groanings that are too deep for words. And so, Lord, when we think of the Graham family, and Lord, I just look to you for meeting their needs and even giving words of comfort and peace to them, Lord. We also just pray for all these physical ailments in our body, Lord. You are the great physician, and we just pray, Lord, that you will provide that healing and give wisdom and discernment to the doctors and nurses that are taking care of these individuals. Lord, and just comfort us as we wait upon you, for you are a good God, and your mercy endures forever. We just pray these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
Thank you. morning. You may be seated. I am Ben Bogle, a member of the AIM team. That's the missions committee here at Calvary. And part of that process of the mission committee or the AIM team is to review applicants who are seeking support in their ministries. And so part of it, the team takes a look at the application, and then as we move on to the next process, bring their ministry to you so you can review it and hear about their ministry, and then it goes to the elders to then vote on support for them. Well, as a mission team, we are really excited about Nick and Jenna Fast. They have served with Crew for 13 years. Last summer, they've transitioned over to Athletes in Action, moved up from Arkansas to the Eau Claire area, and they are ministering to athletes at UW-Eau Claire, UW-Stout, and River Falls. Both Nick and Jenna Fast, they have been married, I understand, 11 years, if that's correct, and have three children, so by my standard, newlyweds. So, but really excited to hear about it. They are going to be bringing to you this morning about their ministry and how they're serving with Athletes in Action. So Nick, would you come up here? And before we get started, I'd just like to pray for you too. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the privilege that we have to support those whom you have given the blessing, the skills and ability to share with others gospel message, to reach others, the lost, those who need you. And so I pray that you be with Nick this morning as he presents the ministry that you have given him and his family. And Lord, may we be encouraged. May we continue to pray for the lost. And Lord, I just pray that this morning would be a blessing and an honor and glory to you. I ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, Calvary. You can see our picture up there. For those of you who haven't met us yet, yeah, Nick and my wife Jenna, we've got three kids, Aubrey, Titus, and Avery Grace. And we've been here for a little less than a year, so if we haven't met you yet, we would love if you came up to us in the next few weeks and introduced yourself, said hello, and we would love that. So we work with a ministry of Crew called Athletes in Action, and you'll hear me refer to that as AIA. From here on out, or Athletes in Action. But I'm really pleased to have this opportunity to share about our ministry. I'm grateful to the AIM team for inviting Jenna and I to share our story, as well as a few stories of how God is moving on the college campus. And while this morning isn't going to be your typical sermon format, I do believe it's right and it's biblical to take these opportunities as God's people to remember and to celebrate what he's done and what he's doing in the lives of college students and in the lives of his people. Psalm 145, verses 4 and 5 tell us, "One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works." And so I've been praying these last few weeks that, am I bumping something, or am I hearing the, just that God's people would be full of hope and joy over what he's doing, and challenged as well to consider how you might also join in on God's call to evangelism and discipleship. So that's where we're going this morning. I want to speak to you of his mighty acts, and I want to tell you of the hope, and that you would meditate on his works and be encouraged and strengthened in your faith. And whenever I'm given the opportunity to share about our ministry, I jump at the chance. I love to share these stories of how God is working. It's fun to look backwards and remember all of the changed lives, all the lives that he's touched. And it's good to look forward in faith at what we're expecting him and what we're asking him to do in this coming year. And I think it's all the more important, especially in today's world, that we take time to recognize and celebrate God's works. Because if we're honest, for a lot of us, it's easy to fall into this despair these days. You turn on the news or you start to scroll through your social media feed, and it's rarely good news. Story after story of pain and fear and heartache. And so while this morning I'm not going to dwell on the bad news, I do think it's appropriate that we start there. As I've often told the ministry teams I've led in the past, reality is our friend. And the reality on the college campus is hopefully going to help us celebrate even more what God has had to overcome in the lives of students. The good news of the gospel is so good in part because the bad news is so, so bad. And the bad news and the reality is the college campus is often a dark and difficult place. There is a perfect storm of things happening right now, from sexual promiscuity, sexual temptation, a drinking and party culture that permeates the campus, not to mention the attack on students' beliefs from a growing atheistic worldview. In regards to the party culture, over 80% of college students admit to having abused alcohol within the last year, and 47% to trying drugs during their time at school. Sexual promiscuity and sexual assault are rampant on the college campus. Over two-thirds of today's students admit to being sexually active. And in regards to this growing atheistic worldview, just listen to some of the things that college students are hearing in their classes. A professor at a Southeastern college said, "Forget everything you learned about the New Testament. Jesus was a homosexual and a magician." Professor at the University of Texas said, "While you are in this class, you will be expected to be an agnostic or atheist. Anyone with sincere religious beliefs will be expected to take off his religious hat." Now, these are obviously things that professors have said out there, right, at the big schools, the liberal schools. But I can assure you, you don't have to go that far to encounter this worldview. I grew up in North Dakota, and during my time in my small rural campus there, the philosophy professor and I were having a debate over the validity of Christianity, and he stopped in the middle of the class and took the time to draw on the whiteboard behind him a diagram illustrating how Nick Fast was ignorant and narrow-minded for being a Christian. And I'd been a believer for less than a year, and so I didn't really know how to respond, and I was humiliated. I've had a professor walk up to me during the first week of class as we're handing out water bottles trying to meet new students. And the professor said, "Oh good, you're handing out metal water bottles. Hopefully all the Christian students will get metal poisoning and die." Recently, a concerned father of one of the young women involved in our ministry came to me and shared something his daughter's professor told the class the first week of school. The professor said, and I quote, "It is my goal before the semester is over to destroy your faith in God." These attacks on students' beliefs are happening all the time and on every campus. In the past 13 years of full-time ministry, we haven't had a year go by where we didn't have students coming to us dealing with this. Tim Keller, a noted author and pastor in New York City, describes it well. He says, "This is an unprecedented time in human history. What's new is the breath of conviction that there is no such thing as truth. There have never been whole societies built on that idea. Never. Few have felt it as deeply as the generation of college students today. The campus is a sort of cutting edge of culture. Ideas hit the campus before they work themselves into the culture at large." Keller goes on to describe the impact of a truthless culture on our young people. He says, "Everyone knows that younger people are far less religious than the generation before. And despite all the things that we're doing for the last 30 years, we're losing them. Students are coming from broken homes, and they're slow to trust in an age where integrity and commitment have little or no meaning. As a result, a large percentage of these students describe themselves as skeptics or atheists. In fact, 46% of college students consider themselves atheist or non-religious. 46%. That's the fastest growing religion in the world. Only 20% attend religious services on a weekly basis. Students arrive on campus today with a deep sense of emptiness. Their emotional and spiritual struggles are more profound than any generation before them. I've been handed suicide notes and had to race to dorm rooms to confiscate razor blades in time. Jenna and I, multiple times, have offered to adopt unborn babies in hopes of preventing teenage college girls from having abortions. We have sadly never been taken up on that offer. Today's campus is a dark and difficult place. The opportunity and the importance of bringing the message of Jesus Christ to college students has never been greater than it is today. I really believe that. So the question that begs to be asked is, what hope is there for today's students? Who is going to pursue them and share the truth that we have in the gospel? Who right now is best equipped to reach these non-believing college students? When Pastor Keller was asked what hope he had, if any, of reaching today's students, today's young people, he answered, "Our best leadership development pipeline is college ministry." He said, We must raise up a generation of young men and women who are proficient in having conversations with those who don't believe in truth, to pursue these very secular people and help them understand the grace and truth of Christ. The answer to how we're going to reach this generation of students is other college students. It is the young men and women who are on campus day in and day out, taking classes, playing sports, living in the same dorm room, brushing their teeth next to these students who don't believe. It'll take students reaching students. And that's the ministry of CRU and AIA. We seek to turn lost students into Christ-centered laborers. I am not the answer to how we will reach them. The answer is the young men and women who have had their lives changed by the gospel, have been discipled, and are taking seriously the call of the Great Commission. Students who have surrendered their lives to Jesus and are eager to make him known on campus. It's going to take students like Carter. I think we have a picture of Carter. I met Carter about this time last year on campus, and he was a freshman football player at Eau Claire, and Carter was as lost can be. I mean, he couldn't have filled up a post-it note with what he knew about Jesus. He had never been to church, and he only knew one Christian, and that was his uncle out in Idaho. So Carter had never heard the gospel, and he really didn't have much of a chance that he ever would hear the gospel. This picture you see, this is our first time meeting together, and he didn't hold anything back. He shared with me how hard everything had been just a few weeks into the school year. And on the surface, Carter has it all. He's young, good-looking, comes from a very wealthy family. He's on the football team, had a pretty girlfriend. But inside, like most students, he was struggling. He felt alone and afraid and insecure. He was battling anxiety. He wasn't sure about the friend choices that he was making. He would go out at night and party, and he'd come back with just a deep sense of emptiness. Until he heard the gospel. Until he heard that God desired a relationship with him. Carter had always expected that God existed, but he wasn't really sure how to find out whether that was true. Well, when he learned that not only did this God exist, but wanted to know him personally and had died for his sins, Carter could hardly believe it. He heard the gospel this day and he gave his life to Christ, about 5 minutes before that picture was taken, actually. And let me tell you, Carter is on fire for the Lord. He has turned from his old sinful life, and he has fully embraced what the Lord has for him. He started to gobble up God's word. He's always hungry and always full of questions as he read the Bible. He started sharing Christ with his teammates and his roommates and his family. He went on a mission trip with CRU last summer, and he's eager to start discipling younger students in their faith this year. Carter was a lost student who has become and is becoming a Christ-centered laborer. So it's going to take students like Carter to reach this next generation. And it's going to take students like Ashley. Ashley was a senior on the gymnastics team last year, and her story started out a lot like Carter's. She came to school freshman year, didn't know the Lord, had never been to church, did not grow up in a Christian household. In fact, she had no desire, and probably still would have no desire for spiritual things, if it wasn't for a young woman named Tori, who was a leader on the gymnastics team Bible study with AIA. And she was also a gymnast. You see, Tori had been trained in evangelism and discipleship and knew that God had placed her on that team for more than just competing. Tori had had her life changed by the gospel, and she knew that the gospel is not stagnant in the life of a believer, but is always on its way to somebody else. So Tori took God at his word when he said in 1 Peter chapter 4, each one of you should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. So Tori developed a relationship with Ashley during Ashley's freshman year and invited her to an AIA Bible study on the gymnastics team. Over time in that study, Ashley's heart softened, and her desire to know God grew. She came to believe the gospel and gave her life to Jesus. She got discipled and eventually became the leader of that gymnastics study after Tori graduated. She graduated this spring, and she even married a Christian guy on the Madison wrestling team, and I got to do their wedding. But you should have seen this girl as Christ changed her life and as she led on campus. Everywhere she went, she had 8 or 9 little gymnastic girls in tow, just following her around, everything they did. She would bring them to Bible studies, bring them to church, and many of them were non-believers, but they trusted her and they followed her around. And some of them came to faith. She has been a wonderful picture of spiritual multiplication and what we are praying and begging that the Lord would do here in Northwest Wisconsin. And these are just a couple kids. I can tell you story after story of how God is at work on the college campus changing lives. Yes, there is a tremendous amount of competition for the hearts and minds of students. But in the midst of an increasingly hostile college culture, God is on the move. And despite all the competition, I do believe that we are in a special time in the world and in Northwest Wisconsin. I really do. As I mentioned earlier, students' emotional and spiritual struggles are more profound than any generation before them. But I think it's precisely because of those struggles that they are so open right now to the hope of the gospel. 1 Corinthians 16:9 comes to mind. Paul says, "For a wide door for effective work has opened for me, opened to me, and there are many adversaries." Our challenges are indeed formidable, but the doors are wide open for ministry on college campus. God is moving right now in Northwest Wisconsin. Right now we have 17 college students who have committed to what we call being on our core team. I think we have a picture of them as well. Now, these aren't just students who attend AIA and warm the seats. We have a lot more of those. These are students who have committed to sharing the gospel with their teams. These are students who have committed to being discipled and making discipled. They recognize that they are placed on their team for a purpose. And again, it's not just to compete and to win trophies, but it's to be a witness for Christ. They have committed to sharing their faith and learning how to disciple younger students. The students that you see in that picture are the key to reaching the campus. But I think we're a long way from where God is calling us. Our vision is to see a Christ follower on every team, in every sport, and on every campus in Northwest Wisconsin. And we want this because we want every student to have an opportunity to hear the gospel. On those 3 campuses that we're on that were mentioned, there's over 25,000 students. And we want every single one to know someone who truly follows Jesus. As an organization, CREW is trusting God to reach the 150 million college students and faculty of the world with the message of Christ. Every student, every faculty member on every campus. And again, we do that by seeking to turn lost students into Christ-centered laborers. And how we do that on a week-to-week basis is what we call winning, building, and sending. So we want to win lost students to their faith. So that obviously involves a lot of evangelism. It's going to practices and going to games and building relationships with non-believing students. It's emailing coaches and asking for 5 minutes at the end of the practice to share and hand out contact cards and following up with people who are interested. It's ultimately getting those students that you saw to share their faith on their teams. We want to get the gospel to as many students as we can. We want every student to have an opportunity to hear the gospel. And from there, we don't want them to just pray a prayer, check a box, and move on. We want them to grow in their faith. We want students to be built up in their faith and ministry skills. We do that a lot of different ways. We've got our weekly meeting on Tuesday nights. We have Bible studies that both Jenna and I and our students lead. But our main kind of bread and butter of what we do is discipleship. We get to sit down with these students one-on-one, one-on-3, whatever it is, week in and week out, and get in the Word with them. Talk about what it means to be a godly husband and father someday. What does it mean to reach your team right now? How do you study the Bible? What does it mean to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit? And so that's, I think for Jenna and I, that's our absolute favorite thing. That's why we still do ministries, because we love seeing students like Carter literally transformed throughout the year as he engages with God's Word. So we want to win students to Christ, we want to build them in their faith, and we want to send them out. We want to send students out into the world as laborers for Christ. One of the best things about AIA, I think, is that students, when they get involved and are discipled, they don't just watch staff members do ministry, they don't just learn theory about ministry, they actually do ministry themselves. Again, that's how we reach the campus today, but that's how they are equipped and sent out after college to reach the world once they graduate. I don't think that college students are any more special or important than any other demographic of society, but boy, do I think they are strategic. You think about the next generation of people who are going to change the world for better or for worse. That's the college student. My wife and I have been on staff with Crew for 13 years, like you heard, but last year we made the switch to work specifically with athletes. Many people have asked us why we did this. One of the main reasons is because that we really are committed to reaching every single student on campus. And that means that there's just going to be some pockets of students that must be sought after specifically. The college students that we're working with, like you heard, they're not stepping foot in church. They're not going to weekly meetings of Crew or InterVarsity or anything else. And to be honest, a lot of Christian college students are too intimidated to walk up to an athlete and initiate a conversation. And so we have this very substantial and influential population of students who are not being reached with the gospel. And so when we first heard about the opportunity to bring Christ to a new place and a new people who weren't hearing, it was a no-brainer for us. Part of the reason, another reason we're so excited to be here reaching college students is because our lives were changed during our college years. When the AIM team asked us to share about our ministry, they asked us to share our testimonies as well. And so I want to invite my wife, Jenna, up. Tell me if that's working. And she can share her story a little bit with you.
Yeah. Like Nick said, my name is Jenna, and my life was also changed as a college student early on. So my story actually begins as a young child. I actually went to a church, Christian church similar to this one, and attended Awana growing up. I feel like I knew all the verses. I could have told you the gospel forward and backward, and even as a really young three-year-old, I prayed a prayer, and I thought as long as I said those magic words, that meant I was a Christian and I could continue to go on with life. So I kind of just did the whole Christian thing growing up and just assumed because my family was Christian, I went to church, that meant I was a Christian. So my life changed. I was homeschooled, so I also didn't, I was kind of separated a little bit from like some normal culture. And so when I got into college, I was kind of nervous, wondering what it would be like to enter into what all the other kids were into. So when I got there, I was just kind of overwhelmed with all the kids that there were, and everyone seemed to know somebody from high school, but yet I didn't really know anyone because no one had gone to my school. So I was very eager, as most college students, just to get to know, like have some friends, have a group. So I was trying to figure out where I might fit in. I did actually go the first week to Crew, and I was at UW Oshkosh, so a lot of you are familiar with that. But I know that they did a good job. I'm sure they like shared like this is how to get involved in a Bible study, but I honestly don't remember that. And so I left being like, there's still so many people. Everyone seems to know someone. I don't know how I'm going to fit in here. And so I left and was kind of not sure what to do. So my roommate actually had said she was a Christian, but she was also a partier. She loved to go and party. She had lots of high school friends. So I was like, well, I don't know how else I'll find a group of friends. So I just was like, I guess I have no other choice. So I joined her, and very quickly I learned that all the partiers were more than happy to introduce me to their way of life, and it kind of made me popular in a sense because I was kind of the newbie. So that was my life for the first 2 years of college. I knew some students who actually went to Crew, some students who actually lived across from me and hadn't known Jesus, became believers. And then during my first 2 years, they kept inviting me to come. So sometimes I'd go in and out, and then I'd go party after. But my life was honestly a mess. And then I also started to date a guy who said he was a Christian, but then later we were talking about what we believed, and he said, well, I think all religions are actually true. I think it's all the same thing. So that actually made me question my faith and think, maybe all the things I've been taught aren't true. And maybe it's just what they told me in church growing up, and it's not even the truth. So I really just went through a period of time where I wasn't sure what the truth was. It was really confusing, really frustrating. But as Nick shared, God was working, and he brought me back to himself. Later, some of my friends from Crew had shared how they were praying for me, just that I would come back to Jesus and know him. So going into my junior year, the Lord just brought me back to himself, and I really started, I can't even tell you, I really feel like it was him working in my heart, just bringing me back to think about what truth was, and even just some of the Bible verses that I knew, just remembering that this is truth, I do believe this. So that's how the Lord brought me back to himself. But I also want to mention, I just feel like the Lord used that time. I later went on a summer mission with Crew and felt very firmly called to go back and reach other students. I think the Lord used that time in my life, those 2 years, to really just see that there were lost students everywhere. There was a whole ton of students that was kind of blind to, as I had just kind of been in church. There were so many students out there who didn't know Jesus, so many people. And so he grew my heart for the lost and for the fact that there were so many people out there who were clueless and desperately needed him. So that's where I ended up joining staff with Crew and later met this guy. But yeah, thanks for letting me share my story with you today.
Thanks, Jenna. I'm going to take over on here. I feel like I was clicking a bunch on here. I don't know what to do. Yeah, and my story is somewhat similar, a little bit different, but I grew up in church as well, but I did not grow up in a Christian family. Grew up in a very legalistic family, and church was taught growing up explicitly that if your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds, you get to go to heaven. And of course, how could you ever be sure when you're hearing that? And so I grew up with a ton of guilt, try really hard, try to be a really good boy, try to follow the rules. But then I'd see this other side of life that just looked a lot of, like a lot of fun. And I felt really guilty over the things I wasn't doing well. And so the first 18 years of my life kind of grew up in this dynamic where it always felt like God was kind of mad at me. Just kind of always had a, I just had a real low-grade guilt kind of all the time, feeling like I wasn't quite measuring up. And I would try hard. And so when I graduated high school, 3 days after I graduated, I got out of the house and I said, I gotta go figure this out. And went off to college, and I just went off the deep end for about 4 years. I decided, okay, the religion and what I thought was a relationship with God and kind of interacting with God, well, that wasn't working for me. And I said, this just leaves me feeling guilty and bad, and it's not really that satisfying. So I'm gonna go try the other side. And I just head first into drugs and alcohol and chasing girls and money, and just for about 4 years, like I said, just off the deep end, I would try and do anything, and still kind of had in the back of my mind a sense that God existed, but I thought, man, is he mad at me. I mean, I remember going to bed at night after partying, just really high and drunk, and just weeping in tears, because I just knew that if I didn't wake up that morning that I would be in hell. Like, I was convinced of that. And I didn't really know how to reconcile that. So my answer was always just go to church on Sunday, try to do better. It wasn't until some other college students started building a relationship with me and pursuing me and realizing that I was just lost that I started to hear the gospel. So I had some college students that said, okay, like, we're going to start praying for him. We had a whole Bible study praying for my salvation. Started sharing the gospel with me, invited me to a Crew winter conference in Minneapolis, and paid my way to go there. I was totally, at that point, I was working in the oil fields. It was just kind of all over the place, and heard the gospel again at this conference, learned that it was by grace through faith that I could be saved, that I wasn't going to make up for this with my good works. And I tell you, the weight just fell off my shoulders. And when I heard that what Christ had done for me, and gave my life to Christ at that conference, and immediately felt like the Lord was calling me to go into full-time ministry. The same night that I believe that I put my faith in Christ, I felt like the Lord said, I want you to go tell people about Jesus for the rest of your life. I think that's the calling that I heard, and so far it's proved true. But I went back to my local little college in North Dakota and started Crew as a volunteer. It's where I had that run-in with that philosophy professor. But it was through that first year of just volunteering and leading that I really just realized I love doing ministry. I love telling younger students about Jesus and discipling them. And so our lives have been changed by the gospel. And as I close today, I find it imperative to tell you that what God has done in Jenna's life and what God has done in my life and what God has done in Carter's and Ashley's life is exactly what he wants to do in the life of all of his children. It's what he wants to do in the life of every believer. The mission statement that we have, turning lost students into Christ-centered laborers, that applies to the church. You change one word, turning lost people into Christ-centered laborers. Is that not the mission of the church today, and is that not the heart of the Great Commission? Jesus told his followers, I think we've got the verse up there, Jesus told his followers that they were to go and make disciples. And he told them to teach, he told them to obey everything, teach their followers to obey everything I've commanded you. Think about the immediate context here. What's he teaching them? Well, it's to make disciples, right? So Jesus is telling his disciples to make disciples who will make disciples. It doesn't end after one generation. It comes down to us. Jesus is saying this to us, to you, the church, today. Make disciples. When I posed the question earlier, who was best equipped right now to reach these lost college students, I really believed it. It's not me, it's not my wife, it's other college students. But who do you think is best equipped right now to reach your coworkers? Who do you think is best equipped right now to reach your neighbors across the street? It's not me, and it's not your pastors, it's not just people in full-time vocational ministry, because we don't live there. We don't have the relationship with them. We don't have the relational equity with those people. We don't see them on a daily basis. It's you. Church, you need to realize that you are the best equipped person in the world to reach your community. If you have placed your faith in Christ, whether that was 60 years ago or that was last week, God intends to use you, and he is inviting you into his work. Not only that, he's given you everything that you need to complete that, to carry out that work, because he's given you himself. At the end of that Great Commission passage, Jesus promises us that he is with us. He says, "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." He has given you, if you have put your faith in Jesus, he has given you his Holy Spirit to live in you and to empower you and to give you the words to say. Jesus is with you, and he wants to use you. And I cannot stress enough, you are the best equipped person right now to reach your coworkers, to reach your neighbors, to reach your lost family member. Yes, the college campus is a dark and difficult place, but it's not the only dark place. And you already know this. You are tuned in to the world around you, and that's got pain and darkness in the lives of the people that you know. Your neighbors, coworkers, family members, they all have emptiness, and they all need the hope held out in the gospel. And you're the best equipped person to bring that gospel to them. So I want to exhort you this morning, don't keep it to yourself. Bring the gospel to your communities. Share Christ. Invite your neighbors to church. Make disciples. If you've been walking with Jesus for a lifetime or for several years, find someone in this church that's new in their faith. Bring them alongside you. Show them, how do you read scripture? What does it look like for you to reach your neighbors? Make disciples in this church and in your community. As I mentioned earlier, both my wife and I would love to visit more if any of you have questions about our ministry. We'd also love to visit more if you have questions about what it looks like to do evangelism and discipleship in your community. We love talking about that. We love training people. I know there are other people in this church that would love to visit with you as well, Dave Johnson. So, thank you for taking the time to hear about how God is moving on the college campus, and I want to pray for you guys as we close. Thank you, Lord, for this church, and thank you for all of the lives that you've changed in this congregation. And I just pray that your spirit would move in our church. I pray that you would raise up people that would take the gospel to new places, across the street, across the cubicle, across their office space. And God, I pray that you would use us as a Great Commission church. I pray that you would fill us with your spirit and give us boldness and wisdom and power to take the gospel to Eau Claire and the communities around us that need the hope of the gospel. We pray all this in Jesus' name.
Thank you so much, Nick and Jenna. So what's next? What's next is that the elders want to hear your input as to whether or not you're committed to adding, with your personal support to the missions ministry of this church, Nick and Jenna, to become supported by the mission giving of Calvary. So let me just remind you what that would take. If every family that's here today would contribute $5 a month to Calvary, more than you're giving right now, they would be our highest paid missionaries. We would almost double our mission budget right now if everybody here would give $5 a month more than you're giving now and designate it to go to missions. It's a simple task.
If you're committed to doing that, would you let the elders know? Yes. We want to add Nick and Jenna to the mission support of Calvary. Would you stand, please, as we close with singing and worship? It is so good when the body of Christ comes together and knows that truth and proclaims it. But it is not sufficient to proclaim it only in here. For out there are millions and millions and millions of people, some of whom you know personally, who do not know that is who He is. Go and share. According to Paul's word to Timothy, you then, my child, Be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Go and make disciples who make disciples who make disciples until Jesus comes back. God bless you as you fellowship over stacking the chairs today.
You are way maker.